Hello. I am Marcus. I was a centurion in the mighty Roman army until I retired.
My name is Mary. No, not Mary, mother of Jesus. Though as it happens, she and I are very good friends. I'm Mary Magdalene. Yes, you've probably heard of me as well. I used to have quite a reputation, and not a good one. But that's all in the past. We're here to tell you a story that changes everything. The story that gave me a completely new beginning.
Late one Thursday night in the city of Jerusalem, a man called Jesus set out on a journey that would change the world. He wouldn't be travelling much more than a mile in all, but by the time his journey was completed, he would have been wrongly arrested, abandoned by his closest friends, tried in a kangaroo court, and then horribly executed in public.
From the events of that day, in a corner of the Middle East, a message of forgiveness, hope, and reconciliation has spilled out to every corner of the world. Christians call this day Good Friday.
Our story begins on a Thursday evening. As was the custom at that time of year, Jesus and his friends had celebrated the Jewish Passover meal together.
Except that celebrated is not the right term. Jesus clearly knew what was coming, and he tried to talk about it with us. It did not make for a jolly occasion. And to cap it all, Judas Iscariot walked out partway through. We hadn't got a clue what was going on. We know now, but at that time, we just didn't get it.
I really wanted them to understand what was about to unfold.
All the men went out to Gethsemane, a grove of olive trees just outside Jerusalem. Jesus was really troubled, really sad. We didn't realise then, but he knew exactly what was about to happen, and it was going to be dreadful. He needed some time talking to his Father God to prepare for it.
Sit here and keep watch while I go over there and pray.
Yes, of course, Master. No problem.
Jesus went off by himself a little way and prayed.
Father, if there's another way, please, please get me out of this. But listen, not what I want. We'll do what you want.
When he returned to his disciples, he found them asleep. This happened several times.
Peter, can you watch for just 1 hour?
But it was too late. A mob arrived.
They'd come to arrest Jesus. They were led by none other than Judas, one of Jesus' closest friends. He'd been sent by the Jewish religious leaders. Judas, the betrayer, had arranged a signal with them.
The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him. Master!
Judah? What the blazes? Hey, cut that out! Leave him alone!
Peter was no soldier, and he had quite a bit to drink, but give him his due, he did manage to lop off the ear of the high priest's servant before they disarmed him. The rest of them scarfed. I'm told that even in that moment, Jesus healed the damage done Peter had done to the servant. It was amazing.
Am I leading a rebellion? Do you really need swords and clubs to take me? I've been in the temple courtyard every day this week. So why didn't you arrest me there?
Jesus
next morning, Jesus was dragged in front of a religious court known as the Sanhedrin.
This troublemaker has been making the most outrageous claims. Tell them what you told me.
I'm not sure. I think I might have misunderstood.
About destroying the temple?
Well, yeah, he said that he'd destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, but I don't think
he's outrageous. He's got to be stopped. What do you have to say for yourself now?
But Jesus didn't answer their questions directly. He knew they'd twist his words. They couldn't cope with Jesus, couldn't cope with the idea that God was for everybody, not just for religious people like them. They hated the way the crowds recognized Jesus' natural authority wherever he spoke. It humiliated them. They wanted him dead. But under Roman rule, they weren't allowed to execute him themselves. So they took him to the real power of the land. Jesus was brought face to face with the most powerful man in the country, Pontius Pilate. This man had the authority to release Jesus or to have him executed.
Are you the king of the Jews?
If you say so.
The religious leaders accused him of many false things, and they brought their witnesses to try and prove their accusations. Unfortunately for them, their witnesses were useless. And their lies made no sense at all. Jesus kept silent.
Have you no answer? See how many things they accuse you of. Well, I don't believe this. He's not done anything to deserve death.
Sir, he stirs up trouble. Do you want Caesar to find out that a troublemaker was allowed to continue inciting rebellion here in Judah?
There was a custom that every Passover, Pilate would release a Jewish prisoner. He thought he saw a way out, a way he could get Jesus off the hook without the religious leaders being able to blame him for the outcome. So he brought out Barabbas, a really nasty piece of work, a murderer, and he let the crowd choose who was to be set free.
Prisoner, attention. Show some respect to the governor.
Right, who do you want him to release? Barabbas, the murderer, or Jesus, known as the Christ?
Barabbas!
What about Jesus?
Crucify him!
Well, this Jesus has done nothing to deserve death.
Crucify him!
All right. On your heads be it. I wash my hands of all responsibility for this. Barabbas, you're free. Until the next time. Take King Jesus away and crucify him.
Thanks, mate. Yay!
We didn't just kill Jesus. First, my men wanted their fun with him. They stripped Jesus and dressed him up like a pretend king so they could mock him. Then they stripped him again and set about torturing him. I hoped for once they wouldn't. It was never my idea of entertainment. But there'd been a trouble for me if I'd intervened. Jesus, naked and defenseless, seemed powerless. But there was something about him which really got to me.
When they'd finished, the soldiers dragged out the heavy cross piece. Jesus was forced to carry up the hill to his place of execution. But the once fit, strong carpenter who used to carry roof beams on building sites was now so weakened by what they'd done to him that he couldn't manage it. So someone was dragged out of the crowd to carry it for him.
We arrived at Golgotha. It means Skull Hill. We tied his arms and nailed his hands to the crosspiece, then hoisted him up on the post that was already in the ground. It's called crucifixion. It's a terrible way to die.
It was awful to watch. They also crucified two criminals, one on each side of him. It seems Jesus had reached the end of his journey. He was about to die.
The Son.
even now, Jesus spoke again to his Father God.
He was amazing. He didn't ask to be rescued. Instead, he prayed for the people who were killing him. For me.
Father, forgive them. They have no idea what they're really doing.
You see, Jesus knew that the only way his Father God could forgive us was for him to be punished instead of us.
At midday, the sky went black. It lasted 3 hours.
After that, Jesus cried out to God again.
Father, into your hands I commit my spirit.
Surely this man was the Son of God. Just before Jesus died, I heard him say something else. He said, "It is finished. Done. Completed." Something else I didn't understand at the time.
When the soldiers were sure that he was dead.
Oh, trust me, he was dead.
We got permission to take him down. Not all the religious leaders had wanted Jesus dead. One of them was a lovely man called Joseph, and he let us have his family tomb. So we wrapped Jesus's body, we laid him in it, and then a massive stone was put in place and sealed.
The Jewish religious leaders went back to Pilate.
Yes, what is it now?
Sir, that Jesus charlatan talked about rising from the dead. We think it would be a good idea to set a guard on the tomb.
I beg your pardon?
Just in case, you know, if he does...
You're taking the mickey?
Oh, no, sir. It's just that it was
he's
said...
He's dead! End off!
But don't you think he might...
Enough! You want a guard? You've got your temple guards. Rome has wasted quite enough resources on your King of the Jews this week. Use your own. Now get out.
So guards were posted, and the Jewish Sabbath began. Saturdays were the best part of a posting in Judea. It was always peaceful.
Thank you.
First light on Sunday morning, I set out with spices to embalm Jesus's body. It was a daft idea. How was I going to shift that stone? The guards wouldn't help, and they probably wouldn't even let me in. I went anyway. I couldn't believe it. The guards had gone. The stone was rolled away. The body had gone. Oh, I was devastated. I'm just burst into tears. It was all too much. Then I noticed a man nearby. I assumed he was the gardener.
Woman, why are you crying?
They've taken my Lord away. I don't know where they've put him.
And who is it that you're looking for?
Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've put him and I'll go and get him.
Mary!
Master!
I have to go. You tell my brothers that I'm returning to my father.
So I did. And guess what? Nobody would believe me. Well, I was a woman, and in this society we don't count. But I'm pleased to say Jesus showed himself to most of them that evening, and I was vindicated. He really was alive. He's risen from the dead. He still is.
And that changes everything. Even for me, even for the one who was in charge of his execution. He's forgiven me simply because I recognized him for who he is and put my trust in the one who conquered death. And trust me, there's no one who is too deep in sin to receive God's forgiveness. Jesus sorted it when he went to that cross for me, for you.
My strength, my song, this cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. Light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day up from the grave.